programs that'll cover that entire spectrum. So that's what I'm going to be telling you guys about today. We are broken into 7 divisions, and I will talk about each of those individually. That includes Human Services, Senior Center Operations, Home and Community-Based Services, Senior Information and Assistance. You name it, we do it. The Garvey Senior Activity Center is one of 3. We also have the Northern Senior Activity Center that's in Charlotte Hall, just a little bit north of the Veterans Home. And the Loeffler Senior Activity Center in Great Mills, that's kind of by where all the sports fields are, and Parks and Rec is co-located with us. So our senior centers offer a very wide array of programs and activities for individuals over the age of 50. So once you hit 50, you're eligible to go to the activity centers. There are exercise programs, learning programs, social programs, lots and lots of stuff. The video that is at the bottom of this is one of our more popular sports-based programs. It's called pickleball. He missed his play at the end there. That is actually one of our most popular sports-based activities. It's played out of Garvey. We play outdoors in the summer, indoors in the winter. We're actually going to have a demo of it at the upcoming Earth Day celebration in Leonardtown. So if that looks like something you'd like to try out, come visit us. You can get a paddle in your hand and give it a shot. So in addition to our sports activities, and I'll talk about a little bit more about those in a minute, we have social programs. And these involve holiday parties at each of the activity centers, card games. We have a Reader's Theater group that started at Garvey, and they've gotten very active. We've got a performing arts group starting at the Northern Center. We do trips and tours. Some of these are coordinated at the Senior Activity Center. Some of them are overnight trips, day trips. We've also got our Learning is Forever trips. Those are day trips with an educational component. So some of them go to Annapolis and Arlington, Washington, D.C. Again, those are day trips. They have a little bit of an educational component to them. Our fitness programs run the gamut. We have stuff that will benefit people who have Parkinson's, arthritis, who really aren't all that mobile but they want to be. We have balance classes, stuff for people who might have joint issues, but we also have things that are suitable for people who are a lot more active. You saw pickleball, that's fairly high impact. We have Zumba, we have yoga. For people who maybe don't like the classroom setting but they still want to be healthy, we have fitness equipment at each of our centers, such as treadmills, some basic weight equipment, that kind of stuff. So whatever you're looking for, we can supply it. Getting into our educational opportunities, I talked to you a little bit about our Learning is Forever trips. We also have book clubs. One of our most active ones is at Garvey. We've got one starting at Northern that's got a lot of interest already. We do computer tutoring out of Loeffler, nutrition, health, and education. We had March was Nutrition Month, and we had a large scale program for that at the Garvey Center. I myself teach occasional Facebook classes at the centers because people want to know how to use social media. So we try to offer a little bit of something for everybody. Also at the activity centers is our congregate meals. Those are $6 for people under the age of 60 by donation for anybody over 60, served once a day whenever we're open and operational. So if county government is closed for like Memorial Day, Labor Day, 4th of July, meals will not be served that day. If we are closed for some sort of weather or emergency event, such as a tornado or a snow day, again, meals will not be served. Alongside of that is our home-delivered meals program. Again, these are served once a day to individuals who are homebound due to illness, to disability, and it prevents them from either getting out or being able to prepare their own meals. They would contact our home delivered meals people. They would go through an assessment, kind of depending on where they live, what their need is. They would then be eligible for either daily hot meal delivery or a weekly delivery of 5 frozen meals with instructions as to how to prepare them. Oftentimes, those are for people who either can get around a little bit and can prepare them or have a caregiver who's willing to do so. This is one of our volunteer-heavy programs. So if you know of anybody who's looking for something to do, maybe want to volunteer once a day, once a week, we're always looking for delivery drivers for our home delivered meals program. Along with this is our retired and senior volunteer program, and that's the next division. I think you guys had her speaking here a little bit ago. So we've got around 300 volunteers that give their time either daily, weekly, monthly, at the activity centers, at local museums, at the libraries, with the mediation center. They give about $1 million worth of service to our community every year, and that's calculated based on what their base pay would be if they were doing those jobs for pay. So they're extremely valuable to our community. Our next division is Senior Information and Assistance. This helps people take advantage of their Medicare benefits, some senior health insurance information, housing, getting financial assistance if needed, kind of getting that ball rolling. Like I said, a lot of it has to do with Medicare, making sure that people understand their benefits, understand how to best take advantage of their benefits, and if they've got questions, if they feel like maybe something's not quite going right, or they had a benefit that's now not, they've been told is no longer being offered, they can come into our office. We have wonderful people that can sit down with them, talk to them, help them figure out either what needs to be done, what has happened, or what can be done. Also in this division is our Senior Rides program, and this is another one of our volunteer-heavy programs. We offer door-to-door assistance for people who no longer are driving, and those can be to social appointments, grocery store, library, medical appointments. This is a free service unless they go to Washington, Baltimore, or somewhere that's a little further flung. Then we have a small stipend that just covers the cost. Again, this is a volunteer-heavy program. The more people that we have that are willing to help people get where they're going, the more people that we can serve. Our next division is Home and Community-Based Services, and this starts getting into keeping seniors who are aging, who may be facing disabilities, keeping them in their home and as independent as long as possible. Studies have shown that when seniors are aging in their home, they're mentally a lot healthier, they're happier, they tend to live longer even, so we try to facilitate that. A couple ways we do that is the options waiver and community first choice. These are programs that enable people to remain in their homes either by helping coordinate a caregiver if needed, helping coordinate a caregiver respite, and I'll talk about that in just a minute. It can also help pay for daily living needs or medication supplies. There are programs that we work with that can help fund that, because a lot of times that's why people end up leaving their home. They can no longer afford the cost of staying there. We also help out with the senior care program. This is again aimed at helping people who are at risk of being placed in an assisted care facility and a nursing facility. We also have the ombudsman, and she comes into play once somebody has made that transition to assisted care or nursing. She's the resident rights advocate. So if something's wrong, if they're not getting their food on time, they feel like there's something wrong with their medication, they're not getting along with a specific employee at one of the centers, and they don't feel comfortable going to the people that work there, they can talk to the ombudsman, tell her their problem, and get help resolving it. She will make sure that that problem is addressed, resolved, and that the person that brought it to her is happy with the result. We also have our Maryland Access Point. How many of you have been trying to get some sort of bill paid or trying to find a service or anything, and you call one person, that person bounces you to somebody else, and then bounces you to somebody else, and you feel like you're getting the royal runaround, you're not sure who to call, but you just feel like you're not getting anything accomplished. This is kind of the state's answer to that problem. If you've got a family, let's say you've got a family that has a grandmother, two children, a single mom, all of them need services, all of them need some level of support and help, but nobody really knows where to start. This is a wonderful starting point for them. They can contact the Maryland Access Point. They'll go through a level one assessment, and that's your gateway to a lot of the services that are provided at the state and federal levels. And then from there, they can get connected with exactly the right services for them, the people that they really absolutely need to talk to, and it kind of cuts down on all of the back and forth and just streamlines things a little bit for them, helps people get what they need when they need it. So I told you I was going to talk a little bit about caregivers. We are extremely fortunate. This year we get to hold the silver anniversary for the Caregivers Conference. This is the 25th annual. It's going to be held at the Southern Maryland Higher Education Center on Friday, April 21st. And this covers kind of two spectrums. On one hand, it's going to cover being a better caregiver, how to deal with an aging or a disabled loved one, somebody who may be experiencing hearing loss, dementia, vision loss, all kinds of things, and how to be a better caregiver. But it also focuses on the caregivers themselves. Burnout rates are very high amongst caregivers. They tend to focus so much on their loved one and what needs to be done that they kind of forget about themselves. And they, you know, start neglecting things like going out and going to the grocery store when they need to, or just taking time for themselves. This conference can help them connect with respite services, which will allow them to take that time out for themselves. And it also kind of, we have classes on meditation and yoga and really just things that'll focus on the health of the caregiver themselves. So it's a wonderful conference. It's tri-county, so it goes through Charles, St. Mary's, and Calvert. Every 3 years we host, and again, this year we're lucky enough to host it. If you're interested, just get in touch with our Home and Community-Based Services Division, and they will hook you up. Now we get into Human Services. This is one of the last divisions I'm going to talk about, and this is where we really get into the birth through retirement spectrum. We have after-school programs we help coordinate. We're a partner agency for Project Grad. We have mental health, substance abuse prevention and treatment programs, some Veterans Affairs stuff. Project Grad, I already said that. So we do a lot in this one division. Starting with the youth and teens, we coordinate an after-school program with Green Holly Elementary School. We have an asset development program that can kind of connect at-risk youth with a mentor that would help them, you know, stay on the right path. And we're also a partner agency for Project Grad. How many of you have heard of that? Okay, that's a good handful. For those of you who might not have heard of that, that is a program that is for teens on the night of their graduation from high school. It takes these kids to the drill hall on base. So they go directly from the site of their graduation to the drill hall. It's a lock-in. They can bring a friend, and it's a safe, drug and alcohol-free evening. Keeps kids safe. Gives them something to do on a night that is historically kind of dangerous for teens. They're free. They're kind of, they just graduated from high school, they're free, they're gonna get into parties, they're gonna get into trouble. We're trying to help alleviate that. And under this program, there have been no incidences involving graduating seniors on the night of their graduation. So it's a wonderful program. We also run teen court. I mentioned a little bit ago, kids who might be starting to go off the wrong path, well, this is another program dedicated to them. It's twofold. On one hand, we have kids who are facing their first offense. They are going to be going through the juvenile justice system. They can be recommended for teen court. Through the teen court program, they'll go in front of a jury of their peers. Their peers will hear what the case is, tell them what they have to do for restitution, be it volunteer hours or writing essays or video projects. We had a team that went through it that was interested in being a video director, so we put the interest to work. Those kids are then required to come back as teen court volunteers, kind of hear everything from the other side, and then once they've gone through this program successfully, their record is expunged and they get a second chance. This is a one-shot, so if they go through all of this, they get that second chance and they blow it, they will be facing the juvenile justice system. There's really nothing more that can be done for them at that point. The other half of it is, this is a great opportunity for kids 11 through 18 who are interested in law enforcement or in being a lawyer or just looking for volunteer hours for their graduation requirements. We have a lovely mix of kids. It's not all the offenders. We have a lot of kids who want to be a lawyer. We're also looking for adult volunteers who can help be jury monitors, help administratively, just support this program. This is the last of the volunteer-heavy programs I'm going to tell you about, I promise. But if you know anybody who might be interested in this, send them to Greg Jones. He's the teen court coordinator, and he does a wonderful job. We also have mental health and substance abuse prevention and treatment programs. These programs help people, A, who are having an issue, who might be needing housing services if they're leaving a treatment facility. They can't go back to where they were because they'll just get back into drugs, so we can help them find transitional housing. We help people who experience chronic homelessness. We have employment support programs. You name it, we do it. Also under substance abuse prevention and treatment, we can go into schools, into day programs in the summer, summer camps, and help with the prevention. It's somewhat like the DARE program, only a little bit different. So we do a lot under that one. And now we get into my division, and I kind of like to say I'm the fluffy division. I get to do all of our outreach and our social media, and I do our large scale events. So I am the community programs and outreach manager. Like it says, I communicate timely and topical information. So what that means is our large scale events, we have three signature events, two of which you're gonna see here, the third of which I'll talk about briefly. The first one is our Law Enforcement Appreciation Day. This year is the 17th annual. We invite 11 law enforcement agencies in the county to nominate an officer of the year. Those 11 officers of the year, their families, the agencies that nominated them, all of them are invited to come to Law Enforcement Appreciation Day. During that day, they are honored by local dignitaries, senators, delegates. We had the governor's wife 1 year, and they all come and they bring citations and trophies and letters of thanks. And we really recognize each of these officers. We also have a ceremony for officers who have lost their lives in the line of duty. So it's a very nice morning followed by a luncheon. It's completely free and open to the community. I hope to see all of you there this year. It starts at 11:30 a.m. It goes until about 1:30, including the luncheon. It's gonna be on Tuesday, May 9th, and again, if you can spend the morning with us, we'd love to see you there. Our second big event is the annual Health and Wellness Fair. Have any of you ever been to that? Okay, okay, see three hands. Next year I want to see every single hand in the air. This is going to be held on October 20th at the Southern Maryland Higher Education. This event has about 75 to 80 vendors, all of whom have some sort of health bent, be it mental health, physical health, all over the spectrum. We also have screenings for dental, oral health, skin cancer, depression, bone density, you name it, we do it. Flu shots will be offered $20 each. If you're using Medicare to cover that cost, you just have to bring your Medicare card and a photo ID. Otherwise, just bring $20 and get your flu shot. It's very convenient. We also have workshops and speakers during the day. Last year we had somebody talk about naloxone training, that's the overdose response. We had another person talk about eating healthy when you have a busy life and how to fit exercise into a busy life. I know a lot of you might have day jobs and it kind of feels like everything gets out of control. Nutrition and exercise might be on the back burner. So again, this is very much devoted to community health and wellness. It's open, it's completely free to everybody in the community who wants to come and check it out. So again, next year I expect to see everybody's hands in the air. I'm gonna deviate briefly. The last event I want to talk about is our Veterans Resource Day. This year we're going to have our second annual. That'll be held on Wednesday, November the 8th at the Southern Maryland Higher Education Center. And this involves, again, vendors, speakers, but this is dedicated explicitly to veterans, their families, people who work with them, anybody who has to do with veterans and veterans affairs. Last year we had 15 vendors from Walter Reed Medical Center, from Charlotte Hall, from the outpatient clinic in Charlotte Hall. We had a lot of people and there was a lot of interest. So this is something that we're very much looking forward to doing again this year. So the other half of what I do outside of event planning is I'm in charge of our outreach. So this is done in a number of ways. We have a bi-monthly newsletter, it comes out every other month. The next one comes out on the 1st of May. That's called New Beginning. If any of you are interested, you can sign up to get that delivered to your home. It's also available at local libraries, at the senior activity centers, occasionally at the hospital, but we tend to run out really fast here. We also have the Senior Spotlight, the Young at Heart columns. Those run in the County Times and the Enterprise. Those are a very good weekly snapshot of things that we're highlighting. The newsletter covers kind of a 2-month span. We also have a Facebook page and a website. Those are updated daily with pictures and information about what's coming up, flyers, all kinds of informational. We also partner with the Sheriff's Office to get information out about scams, especially ones that are targeting seniors. So if you're ever looking for information about what might be going on at our department, our Facebook and our website are the best places to look. So if you have any questions or you want to get in touch with us, 301-475-4200, extension *1050. The star is important. If you don't dial it, you'll end up at the sheriff's office. We also have, again, our website, stmarysmd.com/aging, and our Facebook keyword, St. Mary's County Department of Aging and Human Services. Do I have any questions?